It's a finance committee meeting, a special meeting, February the 23rd. The first item on the agenda is a call of the meeting to order and approval of the minutes. And the minutes are from July the 7th, 2016. So I'll take a motion to approve. Oh, okay. Okay. All right, we'll come back to those then, if you're okay?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll go on to item number two, the Recreation Department. And the first item on the agenda is the circulation pump bid. I guess you're going to be taking care of that.
Yeah, I'll explain the quote we got here.
Okay.
He priced it a couple different ways because there's a couple different options we have. Main issue, it actually started the first week of August during the last pool season. We had a leak start. It got bad very quickly, and it's caused by the pump being wore. The impeller inside of it's torn up, so the pump's vibrating very badly. It's causing the leaks in the pipes, which is going to get worse and worse as time goes on. The last price at the bottom of the first page indicates just fixing the leaking pipe that we have now, which you can do that, and we can try to fight through another year. But you can see the pictures of the pump, the condition of it now. And in my opinion, it's more of a safety issue. If me or one of the staff are down in that pump room and that thing blows, there's nothing to say we're gonna make it out of that room. Because it is below ground, you know, 15, 18 steps up, and this is in the back side of the room.
Those straps that you got hooked to it right now, is that?
We put those around that upper pipe. This pipe here, this is where the leak is currently, and that's at the top of the pressure pipe. So they advised us to put those straps on it, on there to try to hold it together to make it through the remainder of the pool season, because we still had 2 weeks at that point to make it through, just so that it wouldn't just erupt out of the top of the pipe with all the pressure. So we put those on there to try to make it through, and we try to run it as minimally as possible, but to get through it, and we've had different people look at it. Our wastewater department's looked at it, and they all advised me that the whole thing really needs to be replaced because it can hold and can just give out at any point.
And whose advice was that?
Chris Ayers with wastewater, Troy with the Phoenix Pools looked at it, Walt with Walt's Pool Repair looked at it, and you can't even change the impeller in it to fix that portion. It's been rebuilt twice. This is the original pump in the pool from 78. So, I mean, we got almost 40 years use out of this pump.
You said we had two options. That first one doesn't sound like an option.
Not necessarily, but, I mean, I just wanted to put it out there. That's just to fix that pipe. It's not going to say that we're not going to have the same issue when we fire back up with another pipe.
Sure.
The pump replacement option in the 19,800 will completely take out all the rusted area that you see in the picture, in the top right picture, from plastic pipe to plastic pipe. All that will be replaced for that amount of money. You'll have a new motor, a new pump, new check valve, so we won't have any issues with that anymore. And it comes with the stainless steel impeller. It's a 40 horsepower motor, which is up from what we have currently, which is also a whole lot more efficient than the motor we're running now. They're estimating 50 to 60% savings on energy costs by switching to this motor. The other figure on there for the modulating valves, they're actually a separate issue. When we switched over to liquid chlorine last season, the inspector from the state noticed that we didn't have a modulating valve on the pool, which I've never had it on there. Dawn has been here since the pool was built, and she was there at the same time. She had no clue what she was talking about. She says it's never been on there, but she said it's supposed to be on there. And we needed to address that.
Now, can you explain for us what modulating valve is?
Basically, what they are saying in the pull up here is a vacuum DE system. So we've got a tank inside the deck that holds the filters and the water from the pools go into that tank, and then it's sucked in through the pump into the returns and put back in the pool after it's filtered there. This tank's supposed to be designed with a lower water level so that if the pool capacity from patrons gets up quite a bit, you know, 100, 200 people, the displacement of water goes into that tank rather than covering over the gutters, and then you're not going to use the skimmer system to skim the top of the water. So that's what this valve does, is it holds the water level down inside of the tank, allowing for that surge of water from the patrons to go into that tank. So we can still skim the top of the pool using the gutters. But he has three of them indicated. I actually talked to him again today, and he thought one for each pool, but the way our pool's set up, all three pools dump into one pipe and then enter that tank. So we don't have to have one valve for it. And he's getting with his engineer, because the way our pool's set up, typically your main drain is on top or on bottom, and your gutter lines come in on the top of the tank. Ours is reversed.
Okay.
So we'd actually have to build down and come out at a certain height to limit that access from the main drain to allow the gutters to drain into the tank with the excess water. But that portion of it, I can take out of our budget that we have already. Got that in there to take care of that issue. But I know if we do the pump and we get inspected by the state, it's going to be automatic. She's going to fail us because we don't have the modulating valve.
So you only need the one at $2,428?
I only need one of those is all I'm going to need to install, if I have to install one at all.
Right.
If their engineer says we don't, and I can get their engineer to talk to the state inspector and get her okay with that, and then we may not have to get it at all. It's what I'm shooting for, because it doesn't run the way she thinks it does, the way this pool's set up. When we have a lower level in that tank, the pump struggles, and it's going to cause wear on the pump. It's not supposed to do that. She says it's supposed to be that, but it's not. This guy, Troy, actually agrees that the tank should be full. So I think it's just she's been doing it for 20 years, but this pool's almost 40 years old, so it's...
What's the life expectancy on that pump?
On this pump?
Yeah.
He seemed to think you'd get another 30, 40 years out of the pump. You know, not to say that the pool's going to make it that long, but...
One issue at a time.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, I think the pump would exceed the life of the pool for the remainder.
Okay. So we've been more than fortunate with the previous one, with the previous one.
I would say so, yeah. He was surprised it made it that far, as it has. But now you can go down and to try to take it apart, to take the bolts out, until you can get to the impeller, the bolt just rips off in your hand. It's that corroded, so there's no option to get into it to actually repair it anymore.
So is this an either or is it you got to do the first part and you're also asking to
basically
replace the pump?
Basically what I'm asking for is the pump replacement portion, the $19,800. I'll take care of the modulating valve out of the existing budget. And then because we're doing the pump replacement, he's going to fix the pipe.
You won't need to do the $27,000.
Not in total, no. No, basically all I'm looking for is the $19,800 to get the pump replaced.
So is this the only bid you got then?
So far, that's all I can get. There's not a lot of people that want to mess with these.
You got anybody else?
I've tried to get with Walt to get him to give me one, and he hasn't got back with me on it. He does a lot of work for the wastewater department, but he hasn't gotten anywhere with getting prices on pumps. I can talk to Spear Corporation out of Indianapolis.
Wait, why did you put a bid package out? Or?
No, I did not put a bid. I was just getting a ballpark figure because it's under the $20,000, so we don't necessarily have to bid it out. But I can entertain Spear.
They want to get some money in the budget, I guess, for that.
Actually, with the amendments I've done, it looks pretty good, so if he needs the $19,800, it would be okay.
We're gonna bring in some excess funds from last year.
And there's one.
But we'll need to add that on.
Yes, that would have to be added.
And there's one thing that we can look at, that I've been working with, the tennis court renovation that was put in the budget for $10,000. And they've come down, looked at it, had a couple of different people look at tennis court, and if we put $10,000 into the court, we're just wasting the money. It's gonna take $37,000, is what he's proposing to do to that court to fix it. Because the crack got so bad, you recoat the court, you might get 3 or 4 months out of it.
Months, okay.
Then you're just gonna be back to the same thing, because the cracks are just so bad.
So you're saying maybe take that money for this year, and we'll look at the tennis court section, what it's like.
I mean, I don't have any other, I don't want to waste the money, honestly. You know, there's no sense in it, you know, $10,000's not gonna do anything for the court.
Just put a Band-Aid on it, right?
Barely.
Yeah.
Barely even that.
Expensive Band-Aid for 3 months, yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, I talked with Bethlehem, because they use that court for their tennis team, and they said they work with us, give us $1,000 or so to help with it, but I know it's not much, but at least they're trying.
Okay, we don't have any kind of safety issue with that tennis court, do we, if we don't resurface it?
It's more of a playing issue than a safety issue, because it's not that it's unlevel. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not a tripping hazard, it's just the gaps are pulled apart so the balls don't bounce right, but they're spidered out everywhere, so no matter where you're playing on the court, you're gonna have those issues. One court's a whole lot worse than the other, because there's two courts, that's bad, but the one closer to the road is the one with the most damage. So, yeah, that's an option to use some of that money.
The two holes with the tar in.
We only have the two. By the skate park.
Skate park.
The school has the other four. We gave that lease back. And they just redid those 5 or 6 years ago.
So you're saying that instead of using the $10,000 you had earmarked for that, that would be transferred over to here to soften that $19,800?
It would stay in the line, same line item, but it's still a capital. So we would just add $9,800 to it.
Okay. Okay, I think that's a good recommendation. How do you guys feel about that?
Looks like we don't have any choice. We're not going to be swimming this summer.
Got 40 years out of it. That's not bad.
Yeah. I mean, we still have very good attendance up there. I mean, we're usually about 7,000 people coming through the gate up there a season. You know, and then you've got swim lessons, water aerobics, and swim team and everything on top of that. So, you know, the numbers, we're not really necessarily losing a ton of money on the pool anymore. I've cleaned it up quite a bit and cut out a lot of waste. So, I mean, you know, you're looking $8,000 expenditure once you take away the revenue from it. So,
well, then I'll make a motion to end it. Subject to our motion later on, we'll have to put money in the budget, but subject to putting money in the budget, that we approve the $19,800 expenditure for a pump replacement by Phoenix Pools LLC.
My second.
Okay, then
I guess actually we're recommending that.
We're recommending it to the.
We'll be recommending, actually, my motion, let me correct my motion, that we recommend to the city council that we replace the pump at the pool with this 40 horsepower Marlow pump. Installed by Phoenix Pools LLC, with them also fixing the leak in the piping is part of it.
It's all part of it.
And you have the second?
Yeah, I'll second.
And as part of that motion, would we be discussing the $10,000 that we're not going to use to resurface?
I would let them know that way.
Okay. Yeah, so that would probably
really
be part
only
of
an additional $9,800.
So it's only really $9,800 that we're going to be asking, because they already had 10 in the budget to resurface.
Right, it's in for capital improvements, which, if it's in there, they can spend it, but,
You need to put the price of the pump in that motion also.
I'll do it, $19,000.
Did he? I didn't hear him.
Well, then, I'll amend it to be $19,800. Then we'll have, well, we'll get to the budget amendment, we'll have to, I'll put that in there.
All right, so we have a motion and a second. Any questions on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
I really should say discussion, but I apologize, we had it. Okay, all right, so that's what we'll recommend to the council. Anything else?
All I have is that.
And I guess we're reminded that since we are in a special meeting, we have to stick with what's on the agenda, right?
That's correct.
Item number three, the police department. Chief?
Yes, sir. What we're asking for is money to send two officers to National Police Week in Washington, D.C. Not for the entire week, because they wouldn't be needed for the entire week, not for the survivors' plans. That would cover travel to and from. We're talking using a city vehicle, but the gas to and from. And it would also cover their lodging while they're there. Not all the meals will be taken care of, but we could cover that through the $2,000 also. As a caveat to that, attendance to this, it has been every year for the last 3 years, as I've been told. It depends on whether or not I have the manpower to ensure that I have ample protection for the city, whether or not I send two people. And that'll fall into place hopefully within the next week or two, then I'll know where my manpower is. But if we do have the $2,000 set aside for this, I'll send two people with manpower.
So if you didn't have, would you only send one perhaps?
Or? No, I wouldn't send one. They're going over, they're going to share the room, so the expenses would be about the same thing anyway.
I don't know if you want to talk about it separate or any one at a time, but you were going to talk about a budget increase for travel, because I think you're over your budget now.
No, we're, yeah, over the, but that's what this would go for, is a budget increase for the travel, yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I think you had 7,000, and I saw in January there was.
We're at
8,000 or something now.
Travel right now, we had 7,000. Travel right now, we're down to a minus 412.
412.
Yeah.
So the 2,000 was covered the Washington 10 and 400.
Would just cover the Washington?
Just cover the Washington. Well, it would cover the Washington trip, but it would take care of the 412 that were earlier.
Yeah, I mean, you need more than, you got to cover your.
Oh, I'd like to buy a helicopter too, but you're not going to give that to me.
Right. If we increase your budget by $2,000, that's 9,000. You don't get 2,000 to go to Washington.
Agreed. That would be, yeah. If we,
then you had no travel for the rest of the year.
Agreed. If we, we have no plans for the rest of the year either. But if we increase it, as you said, by 2,500, that'll take care of the 412 that were in arrears and have enough money to send if I can.
Okay. I just want to make sure we got.
Yes, sir. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah, because Tracy, I'm looking at your other amendments. I'm not showing anything in there. Travel and police.
I didn't touch it yet.
Okay.
I'll wait for the one.
Right. So we need roughly 2,500.
That would take care of the deficit.
Then we borrow that money, take it from our surplus, the travel surplus, 190,000.
Pardon me?
And then when it comes to budget time, maybe?
Yeah, I've already started looking at that, yeah.
So the 2,500 is coming from surplus?
Yeah, she's, I think one of her budget amendments that we're coming up to, you want to put that the surplus that showed up in the audit into the revenue, because you really don't know that until the audit comes in.
Okay, and I'll come out and transfer the whole $139.
Yeah, to answer a question that did come up previously, we cannot legally use budget or use forfeiture funds for something like this. It doesn't fall within the federal and state guidelines.
And what was that deficit number again?
$412, sir.
$412.
And change.
And change.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I wouldn't have a problem recommending to the council that we amend the budget for the police department, $2,500 to cover their deficit, and also set aside money for the two officers to go to Washington, D.C. for the memorial service, assuming that his staffing is in good shape.
Are you looking for a motion then?
Yeah, well, I shouldn't make a motion, but yes.
All right.
I can. Well, I'll recommend it.
Okay, I'll second it then. Second your recommendation.
You might have to carry that one, dude. Mayor, if I have to carry that one, because can I make a motion and then chair it?
Well, if you're worried about the procedure, then I'll make the motion that we recommend to the city council that we increase the travel budget for the police department by $2,500.
I second that motion.
Okay, it's been properly moved and seconded that we increase the police department budget by $2,500 to cover deficit, and it would also cover the Washington, D.C. trip. Any discussion? Any questions on the motion? All those in favor, say aye.
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 Motion carries. Thank you. Anything else, Chief?
No, sir, I'm fine. Thank you. Unless you have questions.
Can we go back to approval of the minutes?
They will read those.
Roland, I think the only two people was there was me and you, so we can approve those.
Okay.
So.
All right. So
Kelly and Heath will have to abstain. So if you want to make that motion, we can do that.
I will make a motion that we approve the minutes from the July 7th, 2016 meeting. And Mayor, you'll second?
I'll second it.
Okay.
Mr. Heaton and Mr. Kelly would have to abstain.
Okay, and so all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So they're approved. That's read.
And we vote with y'all since we're saying.
Yeah. Okay, item number four. All right, budget amendments. I guess I'm going to you, Tracy.
Greg's first.
Oh, okay.
Discuss this.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. I came here to talk about the Kobeck air conditioning system and really get some guidance from you on what direction the city needs to take. And I've got a crude drawing up here. To explain it, because it's kind of technical, but the Kobeck building has 100-ton air conditioning system. It's got two compressors on the outside, two 50-ton compressors on the outside, and they feed a chiller barrel on the inside. And since we took possession of the building, only one of the compressors, only 50 tons, has been working for the entire building since we've taken possessions, because this one that feeds this half of the chiller barrel leaks. Inside here, it's leaking the R22 system, so leaking that R22 coolant. Last year, we started having problems with the other 50-ton compressor, and we spent upwards of $10,000 to keep it running all summer. and I tried here in the last couple of days to start it up again to see if we were going to have problems, and we are. It's doing the same thing that it did last year. One of the motors inside the compressors isn't running right. So I want, the options are, you know, we can replace this 50-ton compressor, take bids to replace this 50-ton compressor. And I think it's going to be $20,000 thereabouts or a little more. And but I want to caution that you that when we replace this compressor and it ruins it, we replace it and it's good for 5 years, and then the other half of this chiller barrel starts leaking. R22 is being phased out. It's eating up the ozone. Can't get it anymore. It's only stockpiled is what you can get. So if this other side starts leaking, we're going to have to replace the whole system. And that's, in my opinion, $75,000 to $100,000. That'll be a chiller barrel. You can't get an R22 chiller barrel, and you can't get R22 compressors anymore. So you have to replace both of those and the chiller. And that's, you know, those are the options. Replace. We can try to make this one work for this summer, and I think it'd be costly to do that. We'd have to spend some money to keep it running. We can replace this 50-ton compressor and hope for the best. Hope it lasts another 10 years or what have you. Or we can replace the whole system. My recommendation is to replace take bids to replace the 50-ton compressor and hope that it lasts quite a long time.
If we replace the 50-ton compressor and then the chiller barrel goes in, then the new 50-ton compressor...
Next year, that's obsolete. That's right.
So it's a gamble.
It's a gamble, yes, sir. But this one ran, this one's run. I mean, it fed that building since we've taken possession of it for quite a long time. And it's a gamble. You're exactly right. It's a gamble. If it goes down, if this starts leaking next year, this brand new compressor at $20,000 is no longer good. Because you can't get R22 chillers.
Except for salvage, whatever.
I don't even think, I've asked around, I don't think I can salvage an R22 chiller barrel. Right. I don't even think they're out there.
I mean the 50-ton compressor, right?
Well, you could sell it for somebody. Yeah, I mean, you couldn't, but you can't.
It'd be pretty, probably.
Yeah, once R22's in it, R22, it's R410A, I think, is the new coolant. And an R22 compressor will not work with an R410A coolant.
You've had some heat and air people, I guess, look at it.
And his crew spent a great deal of time. We started having problems around April, and it just kept on through the summer. And I've got copies of our current budget where it's at right now. And I think if we took bids for the new 50-ton compressor, it's going to be around $20,000, maybe a little more. If you did the chiller barrel and both compressors, it's $100,000, I would say.
When you get the second one running, is there any risk? I know I've seen this in car systems. You replace a compressor and it starts putting a lot more pressure on the rest of the system, and it causes other problems in the system. Like, could that exacerbate the chiller barrel getting worse? Because now you got two compressors feeding into it instead of one, and it's sort of...
You only have one.
Well, I said, when you fix them one...
We're only going to fix one.
Oh,
we're not going to fix this one.
Okay.
We're only going to fix one.
It cools the building, one of them cools it.
It cools it. And I think that's what the problem, half the problem was. You got 50 ton feeding a 100 ton building and it just wore out. But it worked. I mean, it's worked since, I don't know when we took possession.
This one's totally out and this one doesn't leak.
Yes, sir. This one's totally out. Okay. This one leaks inside the chiller belt. We spent part of that money last year was I tried getting this one to see what was wrong with it. Maybe we could get this one to come up. And it, after some time and money, it was determined it's leaking inside. It's leaking R22 inside this chiller barrel, which is why they shut it down. So it doesn't work.
You use a 50, the Red X one to supply the bottom of the chiller barrel, the other half?
I thought that too. I thought, well, why can't we switch them? And they can't. There's a oil pressure, something's wrong with this one too, the oil pressure. Something's wrong with this one, as well as leaking inside the. And then I've got Tim down there today, and he's problem solving for the final time, I don't think he's going to be able to fix this one to where it'll run right. It's got multiple electric motors running, and one of them's pulling 150 amps, and the other one's only pulling like 40 or I don't know. It's awful technical.
Does this cool both buildings?
It's just one building, the Kobe.
What's one across from the gym there?
That's the school. That's all types of stuff.
We'll see if we can pay for it.
Well, I mean, I've asked them. I even called their maintenance because they used to have that building, and I called their maintenance guys to see, you know, give me some insight on what they thought. They can't tell me anything either. It was 1987. The system's 30 years old. The building was in 1940s. They did a remodel in 1987, put this system in, and upgraded the building. So it's all 30 years old.
It's life.
And I just wanted some direction, what you thought the best course of action would be for us to take.
If I can get beds on both.
Both, get the whole system and
get you some solid beds, because...
Yeah, what do you mean?
I mean, it's roll of the dice.
It is a roll of the dice.
We have $400,000 in land acquisition that he can use. However, it's an investment that's tied up until October. So I'm not for sure.
I'd like to have some solid numbers, so just to compare both options. I can get that. I mean, I can get them both. I didn't want to.
But this has to be, we're going to use it this summer.
Yes.
We got to move on.
Yeah, I get it done pretty quick. I can get the, you know, I was just going to advertise in the paper for the 50 ton and have them meet them down there and say this is what we needed. I wasn't really going to draw out a big long spec sheet, but we can.
I would like to see both options bid out.
Well, just remember, you got a 50-ton system running a 100-ton chili bowl, and and Dick knows it as well as I do, is you have a compressor that's working three times as hard, or double the amount of what it should be, because it's trying to chill that whole, chill that whole chili barrel down, and
fail after the summer.
It's going to fail.
Probably with working. Kind of like our Band-Aid on tennis court.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to make sure.
Right.
From
my perspective, it looks like I agree with Dick. We need to just be good stewards and get two bids, but it looks as if we may not have an option.
Well, you got the other thing, they're phasing out the R22.
They're phasing out the R22. And you could gamble, and it would be a gamble. It's
more expensive.
It is. It's $50 to $80 a pound.
Wow.
And it takes like $4,000 in worth of coolant if we was to buy a new compressor. Mm-hmm. Whereas the R410A is $3 to $4 a pound. Mm-hmm.
How soon do you think you could
I'll start working on it tomorrow.
Okay.
And as soon as I get them, I'll let you know if they accept it.
Okay. If we have to have a special meeting or something, let us know.
We're going to advertise. We'll have to advertise.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
7 days?
Yeah, the 7 days advertising. It'll take, I mean, I guess I have to get a bid sheet up and start advertising for a spec. Okay. Start calling around.
Will we have to, in the council meeting, authorize the mayor to... No, we wouldn't have to authorize him to do it.
No, wait. If you guys don't mind, is let him get the numbers, get the bids, get the prices of it, and then bring it back to the finance committee, let you recommend it, and then do it that way. Is that acceptable?
Yeah, that works.
That works.
That's all I have, Councilman. Thank you.
Okay. Since the COVID building's on here, can we ask any other questions relative to it, or would I be out of line?
I'm supposed to just Kobeck building.
Yeah, it's not.
Okay.
Had an air conditioning unit, but it has slash Kobeck.
Okay. Do we have any issues with handicap compliance with that building?
Yes, sir, we do. We got a letter from Ms. Lindell, Cindy Lindell, and I think that's going to be in the next council meeting.
Okay.
I think it's on the agenda for that, and I've also wrote a letter to the council explaining her. She came into my office and she was pretty upset, and then once we got to talking, I thought she had left under the, you know, I thought I had assured her concerns. We have a chair lift in the council, or in the COBEC, so you have to ride the elevator to the second floor, and then there's a chair lift that mitigates four steps that go into the gym. And if somebody's in a wheelchair, or if they're on crutches, or, you know, an elderly person, they've got to take the elevator ride up and go to the chairlift. That chairlift is as fickle a piece of machinery that I've ever seen, and it's down half the time. It's a Garaventa brand, and the only company that can work on the Garaventa brand is out of Cincinnati, Ohio. So I've had them come down and try to pinpoint the problem in that chairlift. It's a vertical incline lift, is what it is. But I've had them come down and they can't. They would make a recommendation. We would spend the money on the part. We would install it, and that hasn't fixed the problem. It works whenever it wants to work. Most of the time, it doesn't at all. She came in and I explained to her the basketball season was coming to a close at that time. And I explained to her that I was going to go to the finance committee for next year's budget and ask for either a new vertical lift or put a ramp on the outside of the building that would access that gym. I've met with two companies that are giving me bids right now on the vertical lift, and Daniel and I have met with a construction company that is speccing out what it would cost to put a ramp. We'd have to bust out part of a wall, install a door, and then build the ramp to that door to access the gym. We're getting both of those bids together to bring to the finance committee in a couple months. And I thought she was okay. I explained that to her, and I thought she was okay, but she still wrote the letter. But I'm aware of the issue, and it's being diligently taken care of. Because I know that I explained to her, I said, I was aware that we're out of ADA compliance. Mm-hmm. But we are working to get into compliance.
So the elevator's okay, it's just the chairlift.
Yes, sir, the elevator's okay, but it's a pain. So Daniel, whenever they have basketball, he has to get one of his employees just to take people. Because you can't, the elevator's on the second floor. And without a key, you can't get to the second floor because it's a head start. So public can't just get in the second floor and ride to a head start. It's unsafe. So they got to have a key, go to the second floor, and then his guys have to operate the chairlift for them. It's more practical for a ramp, but once you guys see the numbers, you can make that decision on what you want to do. And I will do either one. Yeah, she wrote a letter, and I wrote a letter to send to the council to explain her letter.
Okay. I was there when she came in the first.
Yeah, she was
basketball
angry.
Game. She was very upset.
She was upset when she talked game. To me too, but she left down here. She was a lot happier because I mean I explained we were aware of it and working hard to fix it, but she still wrote.
Okay. Anything else on the COVID building? All right, item number B, council training and travel. I sort of like this. Let's maybe table this unless you guys want to talk about this at this time.
Well, they see how to play. If you're going to talk about the council travel and the thing, Mr. Hagan, did in the council, Roland, pass this municipal order M-2016-17 where it does say only $1,000. So I think if you're going to give more money for council training or expenses for the council, I would think and would suggest that you change this municipal order before giving extra money.
You're talking about the trip to D.C. maybe?
Even in that, the trip to D.C., it even states it in here, only $1,000 is allotted for training. For travel and training, uses per calendar year. The funds may be utilized by each council member's discretion for tuition for seminars, conferences. Kentucky League of Cities, academies, and other trainings and or trips that are to prepare him or her to better serve. So, and it has in there for car mileage, car rental, mileage reimbursement, plane travel, parking, tolls, etc. And it's for the purpose of travel to attend such training. So, it's your all's decision, but I would say or suggest that you may want to change that where you wouldn't be in violation of the municipal order.
I didn't know whether it would be, since this is a one-time event and not a like a KLC, your typical type of training, if that wouldn't be possible to just take that out of the contingency and leave that as is.
I think you just, I don't know, it's going to be an ambassadorship thing rather than a travel necessarily type thing. So
I don't, that's that'd be totally up to you guys. I just thought that you would like to meet.
I went to the meeting Tuesday, but I was just curious since this trip to DC doesn't look like the typical type of training and travel, that like a KLC related type training. Mm-hmm. It's like a one time
ambassadorship.
It's not going to be a reoccurring thing, whereas that municipal order, I think, relates to more reoccurring expenses that are going to be happening every year, no matter who the council is. If that money couldn't come out of the contingency for this year, and if we were going to change anything as far as that $1,000 allowance, I think we talk about that at the budget time, and if we do increase it, then we need to change it. I think you're right on that.
Or if something changes, about my tabling this. Or...
Well, we don't have to table it, but I was just kind of suggesting that. But to your point, do we have enough money in the contingency fund to take care of her trip?
Not at the moment, but that's next on the list.
Well, I thought we had $2,500.
Yeah, $3,500, because there's still a check waiting to be processed for Relay for Life, and that leaves $3,500, which was passed in the minutes when the investigation to hire the lawyer, that it was earmarked for that.
I don't know if they actually earmarked it. They said they would take it out of it up there. I think I was there. I don't know if they actually said it. It's going to be more than...
We'll have to amend that at a later time. We don't know what that number is.
Right.
But
I didn't know if y'all had an estimate.
So how much is the D.C. trip?
Well, you all approved 2,000.
Yeah. Not to exceed 2,000.
So I guess the question is it proper to use 2,000 of that $3,500 that's remaining for this? And then I would think we should revisit that municipal order with the next budget, because the next training will happen this fall. KLC is not going to hire.
That's October, isn't it?
That'll be the next budget.
Yeah, it's October.
Okay.
But prior to the order, the city paid for that one. And then I think that's what sparked this one, was for anything outside of that. But then once this was created, it put that one in there too, that KLC training.
Last year when she went to the Washington D.C., the city paid for that trip all except $123, and of course in here it also lists that you have to submit an expense report and/or receipts, and you all know that, to get reimbursed. And if you don't submit those, you don't get reimbursed. And I think the only thing she paid for last time was $123, but.
I think it goes without saying that even if it came out of contingency, you have to justify the expense. Some people,
right. Absolutely.
Even if it wasn't in there, you require that, right?
Can we just get some kind of clarification if we're wrong, and whether we can take out of contingency now? And I think we would revisit that whole municipal order in the next budget problem.
Yeah, I think we can do that.
And the contingency fund also will have to be looked at as more costs come in that we may have to address.
Right.
So I guess what you're saying, we just recommend that the council would not amend the budget this time, and that we just pay this out of contingency fund.
Yeah, if that's the proper use of those funds.
Oh, it's contingency, so I think.
Right.
Yeah. Whatever the council kind of decides on that.
They did it. That's what was passed last year for her DC trip. Out of contingency. The council voted.
So you want to make a recommendation?
I make a motion to take care of the travel to Washington DC conference for Councilman Copeland with contingency funds.
Not to exceed 2,000.
Not to exceed 2,000.
And I second that recommendation.
And we've already approved that in the council meeting, so that'd just be the recommendation coming from the finance committee.
Where the finance coming from?
Right, you'll actually, yeah. All right, so our budget amendment.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, contingency fund?
I didn't know, I had emailed Councilman Kelly, didn't know if he wanted to amend it now, but Councilman Eaton said he'd rather wait.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd say we'll just wait on that.
Okay, D, reduction of dispatch support.
So in the adjustments that you all have given, the dispatch agreement was through September of 16?
September,
the new one?
Yes.
So we entered into a new agreement that said we were gonna pay, the city's portion would be $130,000. Or 40%, whichever was lesser. So it's 130 for this year. We originally budgeted 216,000. So that cost went down about 86,000. And those came out of the police and the fire department under transfer to E-911.
Okay. Which sheet are you reading off of?
Look at the adjustments.
I'm swamped with papers here.
I thought that was 150,000 budget.
Well, the police had 150 and then the fire department had them down.
Okay.
We split it between the two because they use them.
That answers my question. Okay.
So we added together.
All right.
So now it's 130 total.
And then we need to adjust each respective department.
Yeah. So it's 30% fire, 70% police. I'm not sure how that figure came about.
That's where I'm passing.
Well, where is that adjustment showing up? I'm sure it's in.
Look on.
80,800 and under fire, under transfer to. Other funds needed to be 911. I don't see anything on police there.
Yeah, it looks like I didn't put it. That's my fault.
So what's the total?
Total of 130.
So it's roughly 49.2 on fire on police then, and 80,800 on.
Yeah, I think that's because it's 86 total. So I'm
86
what I did
is
there.
The total?
Yeah.
All right. So that's that 80,800 is
right.
Gotta be changed. The split. Would you say 64?
We get air conditioner for 86.
No, 3070.
So then we get air conditioner for 86.
Right.
So
30
is fire or police?
I think police went down by 50 and fire went down by 30. It's actually in this amended budget.
Bottom line is you're taking them both down.
Yes.
You got to allocate it somehow, but you're taking them both down.
Yes.
To the total of 130. Mm-hmm. And that's what our maximum obligation is on the 911. And I guess it could be less if the 40% is less, but we need the police budget 130.
The other additional savings that we dispatch.
Okay.
The other savings on that too is in the beginning when the renegotiation of dispatch, we thought we were going to have to buy into this Zerka program, and I think the sheriff's department has paid around 86,000, was it?
Yeah, right. Look, it's for us to buy into it right now would cost us between $60,000 and $70,000.
Right.
And we're back
$60,000 to $70,000,
and we're backdooring onto the sheriff's department. So even though we'll be able to use the program, we won't be making entries into it, but we'll be able to take the data from it. So
because we're gonna use the Kentucky Ops
KY Ops is what we have right
now.
That's
what we're doing now.
Yeah. So we're getting the benefit of the county's program, and they're allowing us to use for information retrieval.
You just add more users on, I guess.
One more desktop, and that's it, yes.
So tracing back to that original adjustment, the total was going to be 86,000 was the adjustment, or the 86,000 was the expense?
86,000 was the decrease, 130 was the total overall.
And so roughly, fire is 80,000, and that police is paying 50?
Okay, so police is 91,000.
They were 150.
And then fire is 39.
The total 130, and the excess above that, we're talking about all full time.
Yes.
So we're saving money.
Yeah. So the next one is increased occupational tax. Prior to this budget, we hadn't passed, the council hadn't passed the 1%. So what I did is took the deposits that we made from February to May, and I doubled them, but then I reduced them just in case, in order to get $900,000 additional for this year's budget in occupational revenue.
You didn't have any occupation, any of that?
We had 2.1. because we had the cap taken off by the time this budget was going through.
But the double, you didn't have budget.
We didn't have it because we didn't pass it until September, I think, of last year.
And then we'll get 5 months of increase.
Yeah, because we have a lot of people who pay monthly. And so I just took the deposits that we made for those.
So you're projecting an additional 900,000 for the balance of this part of this year.
Right.
January to June. So, and then is that why you're reducing these indirect costs and utility dividends?
Mm-hmm. That's correct. The utility dividend went down by
$168,000.
In admin. Right, that one's only in admin. The indirect cost is split between finance and admin. And, excuse me, that went down by $610,914.
Now, the indirect cost is just a coup, like the common expenses between the administration and the other.
And finance that we do for all the departments. Because even finance has to
be. Does this sector utility dividends down to zero all the way across the board?
Not yet. Now, when the new budget comes in, we'll have a whole year of the 1% occupational tax, so it'll greatly reduce the numbers.
Well, I'm thinking I'd rather take down the utility dividends all the way across, or rather than indirect costs, I guess. Or maybe, well,
How to do that either way. I mean, the indirect costs, all departments are paying for it, but the dividend, you're only hitting cable, internet, cable, internet, electric, sewer, and water.
So that's a more consistent way for accounting?
That's for this year. Either way, okay. I mean, so but next
six
year.
Six one way, six the other?
Well, the way I see, the difference I see is, there's a lawsuit over taking the utility money and doing the dividends, but the indirect cost would be valid. Mm-hmm. So I would rather take the utility dividends down.
So you'd be flip-flopping then? Or would you rather me just...
I mean, that's my suggestion. I can't tell you what to do. We got to pass it here, I guess.
Would you rather me just not touch the utility dividend? Or, I mean, not touch the indirect cost and just...
But John, I think what you're thinking...
That's what I would think.
Okay.
But I think what you're thinking about is franchise fees that you can't touch.
In
that KRS, I think it's 91, or it's a case.
That's what the utility dividend's for, though. It's like if we taxed our the five departments, like if we taxed the customers. That's why that was created.
Well, are you talking about the KRS? It's 96,200. That the utility surplus revenues can be used for the general fund purposes if it's enacted into ordinance. But I think what you're talking about is the concern of user's fees to the extent that the funds are coming out of the utilities or surplus fees. And you can't do that.
The statute's on user fees.
Right, which is KRS 96.200.
And it can be,
so you can't use
the user fees. Are charges for utility services are like a user fee?
Well, the total between the both was around $779,000. So I could take all of that out of the dividend.
That's my recommendation would be.
I mean, I'm
not the one to say so now. Yeah. Everybody else.
Where are you getting the $700,000?
Because originally the
560, 71 here on indirect.
But there's indirect and utility dividends among several departments.
I know that, but I don't see any change in utility dividends.
Oh, and her change.
Other than this one, 168.
Oh, you've got to go to the combined utilities adjustments. They're separate. So one at the top, this is the adjustments, and it's got electric, water, sewer, cable. Page two has the...
I guess I'm going to get the new one.
All right. So is that 520 number under electric? Transfer to other funds?
It's going to be under the expense. Yeah, 80-20 transfer to general fund. And then the indirect cost is above that 8,000. It's GO number 8,000.
Okay, so you are proposing to decrease that dividend by those figures?
The dividend and the direct cost. But if Councilman Kelly recommends that and you all agree, then I can certainly just only do the dividend.
I think the dividend would be first.
Okay.
Then you still probably have some left over for the indirect.
Definitely.
Do we need to make motions on each of these, or how do?
I don't know.
I guess it doesn't make any difference. If we just, I guess maybe at the end we'll just make a motion. We recommend the changes we discussed in the budget to the thing, and you'll draw them all.
And then
out.
I'll
how about
have
that?
All this ready.
Because I won't remember all the changes that we talked about.
Well. And I have it on Tuesday's meeting for the first week, but if the other council members haven't been able to access it on their iPad, we may have to push it to the following Tuesday for the first read.
That's all right. Okay.
Because I want to make sure everybody has enough time to
look at
it.
Okay. All right.
So does that take us down to H now?
Yes. And that's okay. Where I'm going to answer Councilman Deaton's questions. That's the only one that I see.
Yeah, but some of those weren't addressed here. And these changes, as far as cleaning them up,
no.
Where they stand for the year.
Some of them I did. Because I had to talk to a few of the department heads, but there was only a couple of them that I actually touched on. Let's see. The workers' comp in the PD and the fire department. We just actually filled out the questionnaire for next year, so it's an estimation. So that's it. I would take the blame on that. It was estimated too low on the wages, and of course, it also includes
the
employees.
That's all you could do, though, is estimate. You don't know what the wage number is going to be,
right?
Until you get it in actuals, but you got to clean it up,
right? Definitely. But I did clean it up in the adjustments. The claims, actually Greg has started a back to work program, is that what you call it?
No, we just, to reduce the claims, we bring them, if they're injured, we bring them back to work as soon as they can, as long as we don't violate their restrictions.
So you try to find something?
I'll find anything I can do. It has to be legitimate work. You can't. You know, I can't have them counting paper clips just to bring them back to work, but it has to be legitimate work as long as I don't violate the restriction. And we've dropped our workers' comp drastically over the
year. For example, I've had a fireman as a receptionist for 2 weeks now.
Yeah, and it's probably going to be several more weeks.
And I've had a police sergeant working for 3 weeks now.
Yeah, I'll bring them back to work.
So that reduces that drastically.
Then we're going to use, I mean, it won't do us any good to have them pay
right.
paper clips, because right. it's costing us directly.
Yes, sir, that's right.
Which, of course, reduces the wages in my department because of I use part-time, I've rearranged my part-time rather than my full-time. So I'm not paying part-time CSRs.
But now, okay, that was on the...
That was on the first, does anybody have a copy of the questions?
It's four pages?
This council meeting questions.
Does it have an H on the top of the page? One of them says Councilman Heaton's questions, and the other three sheets I have...
That was one of them. That's just one of the questions he asked.
So I guess, are there four sheets or one sheet?
There's just one sheet for that one, because there was only one question on here with averaging too. But he had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 items he wanted to address.
That's the sheet with...
I just got my hand right. Where's that other sheet?
This sheet here?
That's not the war then. No, that's on the land acquisition.
Which was one of the questions that you had.
But where's the, I don't see a sheet with all the other questions. Is that in here somewhere? I've got my hand written.
No, yeah, I've got my email.
Well, go ahead. You cover it.
I got another copy of my email, my scratch work.
Workers' comp, most every department, you got some entries there.
There you go, there's...
The uniforms for the fire department, I reached out to Chief Walker, so here's the response for him.
Okay.
Sorry.
So we already covered the workers' comp?
I just said it was estimated low.
She's got changes for most...
Yeah, I've got all those in the actual summary of adjustments.
Now, don't we get, I mean, do we have to estimate workers' comp when we do the budget, or don't we get the quotes in time, or...
Well, we just did the quote or the questionnaire right now for FY18, but if something happens, say we get a wild hair and hire a new person, we're not going to have anything accounted for their wages.
So the question is that for bidding out the workers' comp?
No, the questionnaire is, they want a guesstimate of your current payroll, what you think it's going to be till the end of June 30th.
Who is that?
I'm sorry, KLC. So we send that to them, and then they process it by May, and they send us an invoice in June, but we don't pay it till after July 1. Mm-hmm.
But then our workers' comp insurance, when they... It comes in, I mean, when do they give us our rates and they're on workers' comp and insurance?
Same time, we just filled out the questionnaire for all of it. So we don't get it until May, but it's on this year, or it's on the current wages, but it doesn't account for any wages or any rate increase. They raise it every year by 3.5%, and I just found that out. They raise the workers' comp rate every year.
Do we bid that out, or?
Greg works more with workers' comp than I do, so he could probably help you with that.
Right now we haven't. Our workers' comp is through Kentucky League of Cities, and we've been with them for quite a long time. Every year, our second party administrator is Eugene Wilson, and they ask every year if they want us to seek other bids with the other third-party administrators like KLC. We haven't as of yet, but we can if you wanted some numbers to look at. KLC just, all their intangibles, they offer much more. You know, if you had questions, you can call them, and they help with training, and they send down safety supplies and all kinds of different things that I don't think that you would get from a different second-party administrator or a different insurance company. But
I mean, when you evaluate bids and everything, you don't always have to go lowest, but go higher. I mean, that's a substantial amount of money. I'm not just on workers' comp. Our whole insurance package, yeah. I think, is just...
They do our general, or our insurance liability. They do that. They also do workers' comp. And what's the third one? Property insurance.
Our property liability is actually through Collins & Company.
Okay, sorry.
I think we just all bid it all out. Find out. How long has it been since we bid it out?
It hasn't been. It's been a while.
Okay. I think
we can.
Our workers' comp is they're very proactive. They have risk management people come in on a quarterly basis. Mm-hmm. We have training.
Who's that through?
It's through our state association. I'm just saying, and the same thing, you call right. them, you ask questions, you get a lot of support.
Yeah, that's what KLC and I, you know, that's where, but they don't, you know, that's that has value, but we certainly can, we certainly, I can ask you, Eugene Wilson, when they, when we get our numbers back, they always say, do you want us
BB&T to? BB&T is the actual insurance company.
I mean, I wouldn't, I wouldn't say with just one agent, you know, whoever wants to bet.
Well, they'll seek other bids
right.
from.
But any agent, I mean, anybody, any agent or anybody ought to be open to bid on it.
Right.
You know, not just Eugene Wilson, but the entire company.
It's happened. BB&T is the insurance company that does the work with comp, and then it's got a third party administrator who registers.
Right. That's ours. Eugene Wilson is our second party administrator, and KLC is our third party administrator. KLC is the insurance, and we always go through Eugene Wilson. I need anything. Angie, can you call?
Which we met with her Monday.
Yeah.
And I was surprised that. The liability insurance, they base electric and what's the other department on payroll, but for cable. The cable is on receipts, so the more you expand your cable, the higher your liability insurance is going to be. She said they're trying to get that changed
to payroll.
To payroll, and it, that would actually go down a lot.
Some of their coverage on self-insured?
Sir?
Some of their coverage, self-insured policy in KLC rather than that you could be opening yourself up for assessments based on the whole mod factor, the whole...
Right, their mod factor is through NCIC, determines that mod factor.
But since KLC is a group of cities, I guess what he's saying is it a self-insured program that works? They run, they assess us back.
I think KLC is a self-insured, yes.
I'm pretty sure.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. I got right. on the IK on it.
Right.
That's what happened to some of the bunch of car dealers. They went with a self-insured fund, and there was a run on the company, and then they got hit with reassessments. They thought they were saving money.
Oh yeah.
Then they got hit with reassessments at the end, $30,000, $40,000.
Oh yeah, we got. There's still some of those bills.
There is, but I certainly bid it out. I'm not married to KFC. I just like how the. Intangibles that they offer.
Well, I think it's, I mean, that's something when you look at it, and you know, because you don't always have to accept a little bit.
Right.
Well, it's too late for this year, obviously, right. But we wouldn't have it.
When are you going to start for the next year?
Well,
we would go ahead and probably start after July 1 and start, I guess, get a bit
too late. So you're too late?
For this year, I guess.
I don't know. The paperwork isn't due till March the 13th back to KLC. And I'm gonna call Angie tomorrow and see what it would take to bid that out and get different quotes from different insurance companies. And Tracy may be right. I'm not.
I thought
disputing
that's what
her.
She said. It was too late.
It, but
for
I will.
This year.
I can
she
inform
said for
you
next year.
What they said.
Okay.
Still many days left, but.
Right, March 13th is the. You have to have your paperwork back to them by March 13th, and then they. Get it to you sometime around the end of May.
You talking about what we submit to them, so then for them to work on quoting the rate?
Quote the rate.
Well, you could give that to all the other companies.
Absolutely, but I'm gonna call Angie.
Yeah, that's just KLC.
Yeah, that's why I say I'll call Angie and start shop. She has all the rates, paperwork.
Okay. You have to advertise and all that stuff, don't you?
I would imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, Tracy, where were we?
Okay.
We're on, as part of, that was one of the questions, but that's kind of across the board, insurance.
Yeah.
And workers' comp.
It's all together. So it covers your question about the insurance, which is liability insurance. And again, that was, again, estimated low on our questionnaire. Because they come in June. They come in June or July?
Certainly.
The guy from KLC.
He comes in right at, so we get audited. He comes down and audits our workers' comp. And that's right, and I think it's after July. He comes down, and that's part of the reason too. He comes down and audit, he looks at all the paperwork, and then he gives what the rate's supposed to be, what you're supposed to.
The actual payroll.
Right, the actual payroll.
Yeah.
Right. And that's in the middle of July. Same guy every year.
So the other one was the 71-7260 construction meters for the electric department. Jeff was in Florida last week. Probably have to talk to him today.
Was it wrong account number? He's going wrong.
The 7260, the other one, well, yes, that was going in the wrong account number. So I had to change it to 7220.
Yeah.
So we just had to flip flop those. That was the project from last year that was actually supposed to be finished by June 30th. So we had a lot of trouble with a contractor who said they were almost done, but come to find out, they still had over 2,000 meters. They weren't doing anything. We weren't paying them, but we weren't doing anything.
Yeah, it just fell over the year before. I think
right.
But then I guess we ought to amend our budget to reflect that.
We ended up, I was able to flip flop. There's a line item.
I got to figure out which H page is it.
Yeah, H.
72, it's under electric under 7220.
Is that technical equipment?
Mm-hmm. No, excuse me, 7260.
7260.
Okay, I put 7330 on there. That should be 7260.
That's what I pulled it from your quarterly report. The quarterly report showed it's 7260.
No, it's 7260. It should have went in 7220.
Right. So that's been taken care of. Mm-hmm. But is that budgeted or not? It wasn't budgeted, was it?
Jeff, he had something budgeted I think he was being proactive on that. Maybe that we would have that carryover. He just put in the wrong line item.
Well, I understood it was in last year's budget, and therefore, when this year's budget was done, you didn't think it was going to fall over this year.
Right, but I didn't. After talking to him today, he said that he did put in the wrong line item, which is what I kind of figured when I looked at the
budget. Oh, okay, so
it's there. So right. It was just in the wrong
line. I need to probably look at this thick one then.
Look at the H adjustments.
Just in the wrong line item where Jeff put it in there, but it's there.
Okay.
And whenever you asked at the council meeting, that was my assumption that we didn't budget for it because we thought it was going to be done, but then after
talking, it was been wrong.
Right, but after I looked at the financials and started working on this, and I confirmed with Jeff today.
Okay.
73.
So when we get the next printout of the budget, we ought to be able to see it.
Right. Well, I can't do it until you all pass it on a second read. I can't actually make the adjustments.
So we'll go in from 7260 into 7300.
Right. That is
7220.
And there's budget money there.
So. Right.
Okay. I understand that.
All right. The next one has 7300 construction. I wasn't sure why you put that one on there. Maybe because it was so low.
Where was that?
That's street construction?
That's in electric, and that's 7300.
Let me look at my highlighted just that.
Your questions are right there if you want to. That was my scratch pad.
Well, I got to look at the folders and just tell me what I was. Budgeted, there's only been 67, so that's really not in trouble. I think my yellow highlighter went from that meters above it.
Yeah, probably. But I did ask Jeff today why it was so low. Because of the AMI project, which was the automated electric meters, they've been trying to bust that out. We finally finished it. The last meter was put in into September. There are some big projects that he's going to do. We may not get to them, but then he told me today that KU and someone else is requiring some big substation changes, but he's going to take that to the electric committee and talk to them about it.
So probably won't get completed this budget year.
No.
It's only a $400,000 capital,
right.
And you've only spent $67,000.
Which here, I did print those off. The details that goes with that line item.
I think you'll be asking for that in next budget.
Yeah, so that won't get finished this year. Because I said 16% of
So there was a bunch of, I guess every year they convert, I don't understand electric talk, but.
Thanks, dude.
The professional water fees, that's over because of GRW, who is the engineer for the big project for Jessica. I put all that money when we went through budget, I just stuck it all in $7,300. But after talking to her today, she said that it shouldn't have all gone into $7,300. Part of it should have gone into professional fees.
Right.
So.
Professional fees is already.
Right, because
way over budget.
We're already paying for the engineer, because they told us to go ahead and start the project, and then the KIA loan would kick in and would pay us back for anything that we spent so far.
So part of that KIA loan is going to offset some of these
things? Right. So I did increase the professional fees to $70,000 for the moment. However, until today, I didn't realize I need to decrease the $2.3 million that we have in the line item $7,300 underwater.
But then I'm showing over here on your adjustments, you're only showing a KIA loan at like 1.1.
Right. I need to I have to reduce the two. Well, we still have to have the 2.3 because it's going out. The revenues at the top is going to change from. I took the reserves out of all of the departments because I'm transferring in the prior fund balance, so that would take care of. Because it's not actual an accounting transfer, so we don't actually transfer because the money is in the savings. So once you budget or once you transfer in the prior year fund balance, it takes care of.
So the KIA loan total is only going to be the 1.1, not 2.3.
Right, because they have that other project, which Jessica told me a couple weeks ago. I don't know if she's taking it to the Water and Sewer Committee, but they're going to try to maybe get another loan for that part too and amend the current loan. But she's in the process of that right now. And I don't
so
know
the difference there was roughly $1 million on that capital. Where is that money coming from, the other million?
Right now that's coming from our unrestricted reserves. But if she gets a loan for that, then that, we wouldn't use any of that money, the reserve money. We would.
She's going to apply for another loan?
She's going to have, somehow you can do it parallel. Once we've already applied, you go in and do an amendment.
Piggyback it on there.
Yeah.
Okay, that's, yeah.
Did we get a better rate?
Oh yes, the interest rate was really low. It's like 2.75%, I think. And you've got water every year, we'll pay it back rather than using your reserve money, which is mainly comes from electric.
But you did say that part of the KIA loan at 1.1 is going to offset some of those engineering costs.
Yes. So the other one was contract services in the land acquisition fund. So if you look at the summary for that, it has H and it says council and then Eaton's questions. That was the money that we were paid from Jonan and Dimipac. They purchased some land out at Wilson Park. And then we do a pass-through to BIDC.
That's the 269?
Mm-hmm.
But then there was a different contract services, that was a different number, I believe.
5660, that's the money going out to BIDC. Yes, that would, yeah, it would have been on the back. It's Fund 31, land acquisition.
Is that the last one?
No, it should be two pages from cemetery, I think.
Oh, it's in front of the cemetery.
I'm sorry, it is in front of the cemetery. Two pages after garbage.
I don't remember that 269 being that figure. Okay. See, it's 121,000 here on the quarterly report.
For, is it on the
contract, it's under contract services?
Under land acquisition.
121. That was for the Dimipac purchase, and then Jonan came in second and bought some more land. So together, the total is going to be 269. So We've already expensed that. You'll see it in.
Okay, so that came in after the first.
Yeah, it came in December.
Well, maybe it might be February. I got January. I got the 121.
Okay.
Maybe it's February.
Well, I didn't know it had come in, and so they were calling on their check, and I said, oh, I didn't know it came in. So it may be February then when we paid it out.
It's been after the first.
Okay.
But that's why I was saying this number didn't jive with this number, so.
Well, that's a pass through. They receive the money when we sell it. So there is an amendment on the adjustments for that.
Tracy, earlier when you, on these things, you showed that $139,000 transfer in that fund balance from the previous year. Is that, from the audit, is that, there's a fund balance at the end of the year showing $298,445. Is that part of that money, that $139,000?
Does it say unassigned or unrestricted?
Well, it can be unanticipated revenue.
Oh, that was the.
Sort of like what?
That was from last year.
That's correct.
Right.
So you can actually transfer that in.
But that's not part of the unrestricted. That was after the expenditures that went over, and with the revenue, that's what was left over, 139. So that's what I'm transferring in.
Okay. It wasn't 298.
No, it was only.
So you're saying there were some adjustments after?
Well, yeah, the 233 up here.
233 was the Councilman Kelly had brought up after the audit.
Right.
You know, wanting to know why we spent.
Then down here, you got fund balance beginning of the year, fund balance end of the year. There's 298,000 there.
It's different from the actual. And within the audit, she has a big paragraph where she talks about the unrestricted reserves. And also the net pension liability, where it looks like we're negative $6 million in unassigned, but that's because that's not an actual figure that's going to hurt us at the moment. So if you take out the net pension liability, we only have $139,000 because the general fund reserves pay for the fire truck rather than the utility fund.
But I was under the impression that you could take this 298, it's a fund balance from the audit. You can transfer that in this year if you needed it.
You can, but the number I found in the audit was 139, so I will double check with Linda to make sure, to see which one
like
I need to use.
Well, yours is more conservative than mine.
It is,
really. Looks like we're going to be okay with the
139.
Well, that and the fact that you got the additional occupational license. You didn't. Okay.
You might have some money there for the air conditioner, yes.
Well, we have the land acquisition fund. But that's why I said it's invested. Well, if you cash it out now, you get penalized. There were some line items that I did want to discuss since Chief Huron's here. If you pull back up the H and look under police, not really the revenues, those were some grants that they got, and then they sold some vehicles, so there was some surplus that we had in there. The overtime, I put in there to possibly increase it to about 30,000, make it 165. We did have two current officers who have turned in their resignation. We have two new recruits, but they won't be ready until...
They won't be ready until after the first of the year. They've got to go through, earliest I can get them into BLEA, Basic Law Enforcement, is June. They are scheduled for July. We won't have them out on the street working out of their field training until probably February of next year.
So they're going to be down to minimum.
Yeah, we are.
So
we are going to be.
Are you too short now?
Oh no! Right now, with the resignations, I was too short to begin with when last November. I've got two resignations just came in. One has already gone to Louisville Metro. The other one is going to Hardin County to be closer to home. Louisville Metro was for more money. The other one was Hardin County to be closer to home. I've got a third resignation that I'm anticipating in May that if he leaves in May, that'll put me down a total of three. The two recruits that I have in now are taking the place of the two open spots I had before. I've got a third person who will be a recruit going through background right now, and I have a lateral that's going through background right now that will hit the streets as soon as I get them out of background, probably 2 to 3 weeks from now. Still going to leave me too short.
And do they have to go through training?
The lateral doesn't have to go through training. We'll put him through field. He's under the, he's commissioned, coming from another department, so he doesn't have to go through BLEA. We'll put him through some field training just to get him used to the city. But he's familiar with the city, so that won't take long. Still going to leave me too down.
So you're not really sure how that's going to affect you on the salary side, I guess.
Well, salary side is going to be good because we've been too down since the beginning of this budget year. I'm still going to be too down. If I can get another lateral, that'll be great. Otherwise, I have to get two recruits, which is going to put that time further out. What I'm worried about is maintaining my staffing for National Police Week. Mm-hmm. Maintaining my minimum staffing
What would that be?
My minimum is 3 on at all times.
Okay.
And that's bare minimum. Right now at nights we have 4 on both shifts, and daytime I have 5 on one and 4 on the other. Days here is a little busier than nights in the city, a lot more calls. But to cover and to have my 3, if I have 3 down or cover a minimum of 3, I'm anticipating I'm going to have to pay some overtime.
That's putting pressure on the overtime.
It's putting pressure on the overtime, plus putting pressure on my officers who are having to work.
So you're 3 short at the present, 2 from the fall, and then some resignations.
Right, I'm five short.
Five.
I anticipate 5 short.
Of course, so some of it can be made up of salaries and wages for you.
Some of it, yeah, can be carried over, but if we're doing line item, then my line item I'm going to have to change, it, as we talked about, to cover anticipated overtime costs through the end of this year.
So I've got $30,000, that would bump it up to $165,000. That still may not be enough. As far as the salary and wages, if you have officers who've been here for a while, they can cash out all their time, their vacation time for the past year, any personal time that they've accrued, that could, you don't know how many hours that would be. So if we don't know prior to budget, we don't know how to anticipate that expense.
Beyond the ones I've talked about, I'll be blunt with you, people are leaving for money. They're getting paid higher wages when they leave. And
we know we can't compete with Louisville, Lexington. There's no way you can compete against that.
Elizabeth Town side of it, of course, but
they can go to Springfield and make more money.
Yeah.
How about Sheriff's Department?
Sheriff's Department, on the average, between $4 and $5 more an hour. I can't get a deputy to come over. They won't take the loss. Got a bunch of them. They've got a bunch of them who have said that they would like to, but they're not going to take the loss in wages.
Yeah. No one's going to lose $4 or $5 an hour. There's just no way.
Well, you have turnover costs associated with that.
It does cost. It raises the cost of uniforms. It raises the cost of equipment. The cars right now, we're right on the cusp for vehicles right now. So yeah, it does raise the cost all the way across the board.
If you ought to do a salary analysis, I guess, or something.
Yes, sir. You'll be seeing that come March.
Well, you know, at one point in time, state police was one of the lowest paid, and now they've really upped their pay comparable because they realize that they can't keep officers, and it's right now the officers are at a point that. If you're trained officers, you're certified by DOCJT, you can pretty much name your ticket wherever you want to go right now.
And at state police, I want to say they got over 10-12% pay raise.
Exactly.
At once. But they're still 300 short in state patrol, state police. Hmm. And they are reaching out to our local agencies trying to get people.
They're now accepting lateral transfers, and this is probably the second or third time I've ever heard of this.
Yeah, and they're running, and their academy for state police for lateral transfer is way shorter than a regular basic academy for them. They put them out on the road quicker.
Tracy, do you have others?
And I wanted to hit, I did reduce the technical supplies. Right now they're at 50%, so I did reduce that by 20,000. So that would take it down, which would help offset some of these other increases. Another one was maintenance and repairs to building. I increased it by 10,000. They're already over, but they're having a lot of issues with their sewer.
The sewer, and it went down again yesterday. It's about every 2 weeks the sewer in the building goes. Luckily, we caught it quickly this time, and we don't have to bring any steam cleaning or anything in to sanitize the area. But a couple of times we've had $1,400 bills just to steam clean and sanitize.
How many times have you been doing that?
Three that I'm aware of, and I've only been here since November.
Because I know, of course, when I was out there,
yes, sir,
toured to and everything, they're explaining to me that, and said it was really the sewer line needs to be replaced in there.
Yeah, and that's not
$20,000 or something.
15 to 20,000. That's not our building.
Right, but if we're spending 50 again, we're getting like the air conditioner and the things like that. If you're spending $1,500 a pop,
it adds up.
We're at 15,241 right now.
Because I don't
for the budget year.
I mean, county doesn't charge us rent on that.
They charge a dollar. That was under the contract with Dixie. I think Dixie, were you on at the time? I think
Dixie
was here and worked out.
They don't charge us that what we expect them to pay for.
Oh no, they. And I've already approached. They're not touching that.
Yeah. So okay.
Yesterday afternoon it went down. The sewer line went down, so we had both the bathrooms in the back closed down. But we haven't been able, since I've been there, open up the public bathroom in the front because of the sewer line. So, to repair everything, 15 to 20,000 would be reasonable.
That's what we already spent, since you've been there three times, steam cleaning $1,400 a pop.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good down payment on there. So, you know, and I know we're looking, I know there's a request for building down the road, but we got to get.
That's a couple of years down the road. Yeah.
I think you all look at that in your budget request.
We're looking at it, sir.
I mean, you've talked to people and said what needs to be done, but as I understood, talking with you all out there, is a sewer line.
Yes, it is a sewer, and it's going to have to be completely replaced. That's a lot of concrete work.
Floor and everything. Yep.
Now, are the neighbors on the other side of us having the same issue?
No, sir. It's the one line coming out of our side.
The sheriff's department line leads into our line on our side, and what it is the line is put in there at a almost level. So when you flush,
no gravity feed.
It's not just gravity, but when you flush a toilet, all your solids, your water should not outrun your solids. Okay, and that's what's happening, and then it freezes there, and that line is almost level. And whatever goes on the other side comes down this side, and it needs to be taken out from the front.
They tried to put a sleeve in, but
they had
that reduces the diameter. It hasn't helped at all.
One of the T's or 45s in it had separated apparently, and then they did what they call an injection into the pipe. And a lining injection, and it does it. It's thin, but it does take up the diameter of the 3.5-inch pipe. So and I don't think that works very good. So put that new budget on.
What else do you have, Tracy?
There's the technical supplies and admin. There was two rounds of mosquito spray that we had because of the Zika last year.
There was Zika, and then there was two other ones that have come out, and they're fearing an outbreak this year that is going to be worse than ever, they think, because we never actually got a good freeze to kill out mosquitoes this year. And if you've been outside late, they're already out. So we're probably going to start spraying here in the first or second week of March. So
Because two rounds was almost $19,000. So I'm moving that down to agricultural supplies so that we start budgeting correctly for that. And that would reduce the admin's technical supplies. It would make it look a whole lot better than it is now. Then I also wanted to head on to the fire department, the grant revenue. Todd Spalding gave me that big grant that they've gotten. It's like $650,000. That is on a, they have to spend it and then they get reimbursed for it. So he gave me an estimate of what it would cost. And then they've had four other grants come in, so I had to make sure I got those in there. So Carrie went ahead and created for me a fire department grant, so all those expenses will go in there. So it's a lot easier to see.
That's $900,000.
That's $116,000.
$116,000 right now. That'll be for the first 6 months.
Oh, I must have the wrong figure.
Oh, you're looking at finance.
So that's just money in, money out.
Right.
Yeah, so I think it
has to.
Did y'all have any more questions about the admin adjustments or general fund adjustments? So if it's in a bracket in the expenses, it'll increase the line item, so that doesn't confuse you. That's amazing sum.
Can you create a cheat sheet for us that indicates what we have agreed to adjust, because we've been throwing around a lot of numbers here.
Well, you'll be doing a budget amendment for a line item each one of these.
Yeah, that's what this is for. I've already went in and everything that's on here except for, well, that's a, I'll fix that. But this, I didn't bring the current year's budget, but the summary, if you see, this has changed dramatically for the good.
Yeah, you're down about 600,000 in admin, and your revenue's down in admin, and your change, Tracy, versus that's what I'm seeing.
Because of the dividend and the indirect cost,
and then you've got increase in finance revenue that went up about 700,000.
That was for the occupational tax.
Okay. Then you brought in 2 million prior year fund.
For the combined utilities. The unrestricted reserve, we have about 6.4 million after the audit was completed. Mm-hmm. So I'm only bringing in 2 million. That would take care of any projects that the electric department had. They currently were in the revenue line item 8990 as transfer from reserves. But that's not really an adjustment. So if I took all of those out and just put in this prior fund balance, so that would offset those costs.
So that 2 million here is not part of that won't be some money spent on that million.
Part of it, yes. If we get the water. She can get the additional KIA loan, then we won't use.
So where did that total come from? No.
This comes from the audit. We had 6.4 million left and unrestricted. I only put 2 million in here. I didn't want to put all of it in there.
And electric revenues, you projected them down by about 400,000.
Because I took out the 520 for the capital projects and the revenue, and that's what that 2 million is covering now. If you look at the summary of adjustments for the combined utilities,
yeah, 550 on electric.
Yeah, so we're taking out 520 and it says transfer from reserves. It's not an actual accounting, but that's what we do when we start the budget to show that we're using the unrestricted reserves. So I went through all the departments and just took those out. Because it's just cleaner to use the prior year fund balance.
Yeah, but it was showing up in revenue reduction. I'm thinking that shows more than expense reduction.
No, because it's, if you look in the revenue financials, 8990 transfer from reserves for 8900 in the revenue. There was 520 in there for the capital projects. I've taken that out, so the revenue is going to go down.
Okay.
In electric, this 2 million from the prior year fund balance is going to cover that 520.
Right. And then water, the same thing.
Yes.
Water went down by like 1.3.
Same thing, took out the transfer from reserves. That's why I said we'll probably have to do our first read, two meetings from now, rather than Tuesday. March 3rd, I guess.
Okay.
Can you have a first reading in the working session? Well, it's no longer, it's not going to be now.
No, it's a, it's a council meeting. So yes, you can.
It's 7.
March 2nd.
7.
We'll probably have to do the first read then rather than Tuesday. So that everyone has a chance.
Then again on the 14th.
And this.
If it goes through.
It might be that I didn't want to put on the agenda next time to explain.
Unless you remember that for me. I will. I was planning on having a memo, but it was so much. I do apologize for that.
Then maybe you'll send it out, then you explain to them and then have the first reading. So.
Okay.
That's my suggestion.
No, I agree.
I don't tell anybody what to do.
I would agree with that too.
Because there's a lot of changes.
There is a lot of changes.
But everything all being good.
Tracy, this ordinance, that's just like a draft.
Yeah, that's what, right now it's the draft. So it shows where we've increased revenues, increased some expenditures. We decreased expenditures in the combined utilities originally what we had budgeted.
So you'll basically go back there and massage all this from today and then change these numbers.
Correct.
Is there anything else?
Too many papers.
Yeah, I know. The tree.
They all got numbers on them, so it's hard to find out which one.
All right. On that number one, is there a grammatical error or something in there, or am I just misreading that?
Where?
Is that 8 million?
Huh?
On right
the draft.
Yes, it is.
Revenues from 8.4 million to 8.7 million. You look in the ordinance?
Like I said, it was on there. Never mind.
Well, now you'll break that down to line item somewhere. Attach it to that ordinance, please.
This attaches to it for departments, and then the line items are just stored in the clerk's office to look at.
Because when the budget was passed, they had line items, and I think you need
they to did, that. But they only attached this to it to show departmentals because in the past they've always gone over line items and under.
This will actually work here.
When I pulled the ordinance, all I had was this. When I asked for the ordinance, I got a copy of the ordinance.
It's
this.
That's
all I saw.
Misreading that?
They're both
commas.
39.
But I'll find out. I think when you pass the budget, you pass the budget that way, not by line item. And that way, you don't have to go through and change the budget every time a line item goes over.
But we are trying to implement a
POs.
Electronic PO system.
Oh, yeah, it should be a
that way, they have to enter in what they want to spend then, and if there's no money, they don't want to enter it, so then they can't spend it. They would have to come back to the council.
Because in the past, they just go to Busix or go wherever, and they just charge it to whatever account, and even when Bobby Simpson and I've been on the council, I've always asked for POs, and that's what she's implementing.
Yeah.
And getting it done now is to get POs. So you go there, everybody has a PO, you know what it goes to, who it's charged to, and where it's going to go on what job.
Well, that's a huge headache. You and your music bill in or whatever bill.
Well, you can do a blanket PO with that one, but you
got to
be careful with those
too. But then you don't know what department. I mean, you got
the
office.
They have the department heads. I have to start doing that. Yeah. So.
But with a look at it with a $49 million a corporation, you got to change.
Yep.
All right. Anything else, Tracy?
No.
Our minds clear.
I'm ready now.
Okay, motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Adjourn.